Hey everyone, welcome to Nurse Talk. I'm Mike.
And I'm Chris.
And today we're just going to do a quick review or our thoughts and first impressions on the PlayStation 5. That's right, we both officially have the PlayStation 5. It launched worldwide on November 12th. We got ours a day later, on the 13th, but we've had some time to kind of run through its paces. We both played a little bit of Astrobot. You played a couple of other games.
Yeah, a little bit of Ghost of Tsushima, some Fortnite with my son, so I'll talk about those as well.
Absolutely. And if you don't want, and I say spoilers, there isn't really any big spoilers in Astrobot, but we are going to discuss kind of how the controller feels, because it's really like a showcase for the controller and what it can do, and hopefully gives developers some really great ideas on how to use it in their games. But a little bit about the interface, the snappiness of it, and our overall thoughts on kind of what you get out of the box. So with that, let's dive right in. So PlayStation 5.
Yeah. So Astro's Playground, I found, was obviously built just to showcase every feature that PlayStation 5 can have with the controls and the feel and everything like that. So it kind of introduces you to, you know, movement, all the things that you can do, the haptic feeling. I love the part where they throw all the little Astros in and you can tilt it and kind of feel like they're all there. And then it goes and you can feel all the way down to the curve. So I like the features.
The sound, the speaker.
Yes. Yeah. And I love that there's a speaker right in there and that you can really feel it. The vibration feels great. You know, the feedback feels really great. So I love that this is a game that when you open the box, it's already on your system. And you can kind of test it to see what you may expect from some games, and most games maybe down the line a few years, but upcoming, what you can expect and be excited for.
Absolutely. Now, Astrobot is basically a love letter to PlayStation fans. It is basically the history of PlayStation in a nutshell, which I thought was a great surprise. I didn't expect it. Throughout it, you're going to find artifacts and special unlockables, and it literally is the history of PlayStation from the first generation all the way through the fourth generation. I thought that was really smart. A lot of cool things I saw that I wasn't aware of, because I never owned a PlayStation 1 or PlayStation 2. I was a big Nintendo fan, had all the Nintendo consoles, and then I jumped onto Xbox when it launched. I only got a PS3 midway through the generation to try some of the exclusives out, but pretty much stayed away from PlayStation for the most part. And it wasn't until I got hooked on those, you know, Uncharted and God of War and things like of that nature that made me like, okay, I'm buying PS4 when it first launches, and obviously PS5 when it first launches. Yeah. So for me, kind of dipping back in the history, a lot of the stuff I kind of seen or heard of, but there's a lot that I didn't. I thought that was really cool, really great touch. Showing a lot of like these moments and memories, especially for people who've been with Sony since the beginning. From sounds to like visuals to like cute little callbacks to specific games.
Yeah.
I thought it was extremely well done. Like you said, a great showpiece for what the controller can do. I was blown away and amazed at the different experiences that they kind of throw in there.
Yeah. Like and ice, sand, wind, like you can feel all the elements. You know, all they're missing is really like the heat,
the temperature,
feeling, something like that, temperature wise. But so I'm one of those people that had from PlayStation 1 all the way to PlayStation 5 now. So it was great to see all the callbacks. One part, there's a box. If you hit it, it's like a solid snake kind of Metal Gear solid. With the, so I was like, oh, that's such a throwback to PS1 and like where it started for me.
Yes.
That was like my main game that I played in PS for the first gen PlayStation.
Yeah. We saw the Final Fantasy VII sword from Cloud, the Buster sword. Like, we just saw so many
little Easter
moments.
Eggs and things that everyone that's kind of been with PlayStation from either the beginning or currently, they can pick up on things or know things that are, you know, common in the past or people have talked about it and they've heard about. So it's so great to see, as you said, a love letter to all those, you know, history and everything that they've done there. So.
Yep, they improved the touchpad. I thought it was going to be more of the same, but it now supports dual finger. Or if the first one did, I didn't really notice that. I used it for more clicking and an odd swipe. But this one actually, the swiping feels great. It actually feels a little bit like you're doing a zipper. And it actually feels like the bumps on it, like you're doing up a zipper. And I'm like, how do they get that rumble up on that spot of the controller so that you literally feel it on your finger, but nowhere else? Like you don't feel it on your handle. So the comment that I wanted to say is that the rumble is very similar to the Joy-Cons on the Switch. It's HD rumble. So you're getting that like very specific detailed Rumbles and the different strengths of the Rumbles in different areas to kind of help coincide with what you're experiencing on the screen. So like you said, you can feel like a bunch of different characters inside the controller as you move it. You can feel the Rumble kind of move down, and so you get that precision. So that's kind of very similar to what the Switch has. But what's very unique is the haptic feedback triggers, the pressure of it, the Rumble in conjunction with it. It's just a completely different experience. That bundle with the HD Rumble and like I said, the touchpad, the gyro works so well.
Yes, yes.
Doesn't desync or anything like that. Just overall a great experience. And then they bundled in features like on the Wiimote, we had the speaker. They have that in the controller and much higher quality speaker. Yeah. And then of course they have the microphone, which we had an experience on the 3DS with certain games where you can incorporate that as well. So they make use of you blowing into the controller or, you know, sounds from the controller and stuff like that. Just everything bundled together just makes this a unique experience.
Right.
And it's definitely, I have to say, if third parties make use of this, and I really hope they do, will be the platform of choice. Why get it on Xbox if I can get this cool experience?
More immersive feeling in it, yeah. So like you said, we have gotten these things in one or two pieces, but this is kind of everything together in one package. So to play games, hopefully in the future, other than Astro's Playground, which obviously was built for this, I hope, like you said, obviously first persons will, or first, you know, PlayStation owned ones should take advantage of this. But like you said, third party ones really, really, really should get on board with this. And just, you know, it helps with the game feeling. You get more into it. You feel like you're a part of it. And so I hope that they catch on.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that another point I wanted to make is that I think that for most PlayStation 5 owners, it is a free game that comes with the system. I do recommend that it's your first experience with that PlayStation. And when I booted it up, I was like, I'm not inserting a game. It walks you. Well, let's talk about it. So we unboxed the PlayStation. Very, very simple, very straightforward. Install the base.
Yeah.
Plug in the power cable, HDMI cable, power it on, you're good to go. Like, there's no cord into brick into. It's very straightforward, very minimalist, very easy to go. And it boots up and it's quick and it's very easy. And I thought that process was really awesome.
Yeah.
The way it was packaged and everything. You boot it up and it walks you through like, okay, we're going to do a system update. Does the update? And it says, okay, while we're setting this up, if you want, put a disc in, we can install your first game while we're doing the setup. I'm like,
which
that's very smart.
Which I did.
So
I
you
took
did
advantage
that.
Of that.
I did. I was like, no, I'm going to play Astrobot first. So I don't want to have like any other games. I want to just jump right into this experience. So I got registered. It asked me if I wanted to move all my stuff from my PlayStation 4 over. I did not have a spare network cable for my PS5 yet. I got to get one. So I didn't want to do it through Wi-Fi. So I said, no, I'll skip that. I'll do that later. And then I realized, well, as a PlayStation Plus member, all my saves are in the cloud. So I just went into my PlayStation 5, went into my cloud save, and was able to download all my cloud saves within like a few minutes. It was so quick. And then I was like, okay, the games I'll have to install, which is fine. I can transfer that or download them again. But my saves went so quick, I didn't need to go through the network. Now, in the case of my son, who doesn't have PlayStation Plus, his profile is on the PS4. So I will have to plug it in and transfer it over. So that's a step I will do and see how quick it is. But I thought, again, it was so seamless and so quick and easy to get your stuff over, even if just downloading it from the cloud. I thought it was really, really smart.
Yeah. So I did transfer myself at the time over wireless. So as long as you have your PS4 and PS5 on the same network, it's not a problem. They will speak to each other and it will transfer over.
How long did that take to you, roughly, do you think?
Because
is it also transferring like games over, like installed games? Or is it just your saves? Like, is it actually saying, you have this
both.
Game installed, install the game on the new
system.
So you
can install some. So it'll bring your library over and then it'll bring your saves over as well. So. But I was able to play Astrobot while I was doing some of that as well. So it was kind of in the background downloading games. So the saves were pretty quick. It flew by really quickly, which was nice. And then I was able to test it out that way. But yeah, so not too bad. My son as well, I need to connect them and actually get it over because it wasn't in the cloud. But yeah, it worked out pretty well.
Yeah, very smooth. So the point I was getting at was in regards to like how quick and snappy things are, things install. Again, jumping into a game, it's really, really quick. Obviously, everyone talked about quick boot up times, and it has been super, super efficient. Now, Astrobot isn't a big game, so I wouldn't expect it to be load times or anything like that. So it has been very, very instantaneous. But I did decide I wanted to see how quick this SSD experience would be. And the biggest game for me has been Avengers. Yeah. I've been playing Avengers a lot on PS4. And I'm like, I want this, my PS5, because I want this to stop crashing. I want the load times to pick up because that was a big issue. They haven't released, obviously, the PS5 version yet. So as PS4 owners, we get a free upgrade to the PS5. That is unavailable yet. It'll be available sometime next year. So it's not going to be optimized. It will get faster, it will look better, but until then, at a very minimum, running on this type of hardware, it should load quicker, right? The processor is there, the graphics card is faster, you can generate the graphics faster. Not only that, you have an SSD to load the areas quicker, so overall loading time should be cut down. Yeah. I put in the game, I installed it, went pretty smoothly, I launched the game, and I can say that I basically from the main menu, you have the campaign, Avengers Initiative, and Marketplace. So I click the Avengers Initiative, and then you get through this loading screen where it shows all the characters. And on the PlayStation 4, you get through pretty much all characters before it loads up the screen. So it's roughly like a minute 20 seconds.
Yeah.
And I counted when I clicked that button, and it was within 30 seconds I was in the game. So it did cut it down. It still was a little long for my taste. 30 seconds is still too long for this type of next gen, when I'm hearing 10-second load times, 5-second load times.
Yeah.
This should be a lot quicker, but I'm expecting that once we get the optimized PS5 version, when they're actually understanding this is where the hard drive is, here's the GPU, this is how we're going to load games and how we're going to take advantage of it, I'm hoping that 30 seconds can drop down to like 15. And if I can see that, then I'm happy. That's what we should be expecting on SSD drives, especially when you're talking M.2, you know, PCIe, not PCIe, but super fast SSD drives that are connected to the processor. You want as quick load times as possible. So I was impressed. It was better. I didn't jump into a mission yet to see again how long the mission loading would take, but the initial loading was pretty snappy. I thought that was pretty good. It was an improvement. I can't wait to see the optimized version.
Definitely, yeah. So after playing Astro's Playground, I jumped into Ghost of Tsushima. Mm. It loaded quite quickly. It asked if I wanted the optimized version, which I said yes to. So I got that, and everything was just really snappy. You can kind of they use the haptic a bit, so they've added that in as part of the update. So it was interesting to get used to that and get the buttons down again. It's been a little bit since I played it, but looks beautiful, plays just as well as I remember, and just, you know, feels really good, like you're more immersed into the game.
So yeah,
it was interesting to play. Took me a little bit to get used to. I felt off a little bit at the beginning, like I didn't help that I hadn't played and forgotten the buttons a little bit. Yeah. But once I got back into it, it was like riding a bike, so I really enjoyed it.
Now, having played the PS5 DualSense and obviously coming off the PS4, features aside, just the feel of the controller, the half the weight, I think the PS5 controller I don't think I could go back to a PS4 controller.
Yeah, I don't think tough. I'll be playing.
Like the PS4 extra thing. Weight is great. You want that heft, you want that, like, I'm feeling holding a solid controller. I did charge it. So the day I got it, I installed, I downloaded Bugsnax. Again, for those who are watching,
yes.
Download it. It's free for the month right now. You don't want to pay for that game. That game is great. I mean, it's worth paying for the game, but I would say hold off. You can get it for free now. Make sure, even if you don't have a PS5, log in to the website on the PlayStation Store and download it, add it to your library.
Yeah. So they have two PS4 games and one PS5 game currently going every month. So definitely get that one onto your PS Plus
account. Yeah, so and then you have it. Yeah. I can't wait to dive in that. But what was I saying? In regards to the controller, so
yeah
just the feel of it, the you know, the triggers, the buttons, the feel of the buttons, the D-pad, just everything, the grips, the textures.
On the Joy-Con
is so great. Yeah. I'm like, I don't want to go back, and I'm immediately thinking I want to go buy another controller. But my point was that booted up the system, I plugged in my controller. And then as soon as I booted everything up and everything installed, I shut it off. I didn't play Astros right away. And I was like, I'm going to let my controller charge. And then I waited a few hours, did some stuff with the family. And then when I went downstairs and booted it up to try AstroBot, I unplugged it. I haven't charged it since. So I've used it for about 3 or 4 hours yesterday, roughly. And then today I played for another, my son played for about 2-ish hours. And then I played myself for about another hour. So we're looking about 6 to 7 hours roughly. And I have not got any notification of needing to charge it yet, which is great. Beautiful. And this is all using AstroBot. So it's using the gyro, it's using the haptic, it's using the rumble, it's using everything the controller has. So in some games, they might make use of it in subtle ways, and so it won't be as much of a drain. I expect a game that's using all of it at the same time is going to be the most wear and tear on your battery. Right. And so far, I've had no issues with it. which I'm impressed with. I'm purposely not charging it. I want to see how much more I can get out of it before it dies to get an idea. Is it better battery than the PS4? Because I was not impressed with the PS4 having to charge it almost every PlayStation. Like every other day I had to charge it. And my Xbox One will last 30 days on batteries. Well, the battery pack will last at least a week.
Yeah.
And then my Switch Pro Controller lasts 80 hours. Like it's insane. It just, I can have that thing unplugged for weeks and it still works. It's really great. So I'm hoping that the PS5 will last at least, you know, 2 8-hour playing sessions, like a good 10, 15 hours. That'll make me impressed, especially since you're now paying for all those features. You're paying a lot more for the controller. It's expensive to buy replacement because you can't buy the battery. Yeah. To buy replacement controllers are expensive. So that's why I didn't buy a second one right away. I'm like, I might as well wait because if the battery isn't that great, buying one in year two or year three will help the controllers last longer and longer and longer.
Exactly, yeah. So I got the package that came with two controllers. It's the only one that I could get available, which is fine because I typically buy two controllers right away anyway. So I'm that kind of guy that will just pop in.
Just swap one.
Yeah, yeah. So I've only obviously used one. The other one was charging today, but I charged up the first one after I set it up. So like you said, it's felt really, really good. Going back to the PS4, I don't want to say feels plasticky, but it's like very more delicate and more, I don't know, because of the weight of it, and it just feels more flimsy. And this one feels like it's a solid machine that will last a while. So I'm hoping it does at least, because I have two of them. So far I haven't charged it since the initial charging. I haven't played as much, probably in 3.5 hours in total, maybe 4 hours in total so far. So, and everything's been good, no flashing, no, you know, disconnect or anything like that. And it has felt really, really good. And then playing Fortnite as well, it does give a little bit of the feedback and resistance for the triggers, but it doesn't feel like you're shooting a gun or anything like that. It just, you get a little bit more toughness and resistance. So you get more of that feeling. So it felt good as well for that game. So I'm looking forward to past games, replaying them to see what it feels like, as well as the future games to see what they really take advantage of.
Yeah, so on the new console, so when it went for me to download my saves, I went to my library. I was like, what am I going to install? So I installed Bugsnax. I'm like, well, I could immediately just go through the PlayStation Plus collection and install a bunch of games. But I'm like, I'm limited to 600 gigs. I don't want to fill this thing up, especially with an SSD, to delete and write, delete, write, delete, write. You want really want to make sure you're installing games you're going to play, not just have games to just have games. So I was going through my list and I'm like, you know what? I'm going to put Battlefront 2, my digital edition, because I probably will go back to it. My kid will go back to it. And now load times will be quicker. And I'm interested to see if it is an older game. So I don't expect it to make use of anything, but it would be nice if there was some sort of haptic or something. Now, there haven't been any updates, so I doubt it. But I did want to try it just to see if by default the controller knows, oh, you're pulling this in. Let's provide some sort of resistance. Just
as a natural thing for all games that going forward. Yeah, so I'm not sure if Fortnite had, it was updated. So
I did get
the updated PS5 version because it asked me for that as well. So I did upgrade to that, but maybe that's why. Yeah, it's interesting to see what they have upgraded or updated to PS5.
Absolutely. So I'm really looking forward to that. And like I said, I purposely have been holding off on Ghost and Last of Us 2. So those are games I want to get and install and play those right away, along with
Squadrons. We have
Squadrons, Assassin's Creed Valhalla.
Oh, man, I heard good things.
It's been so great. And I still want to run through Odyssey. And then, of course, we have Miles Morales, which I'm waiting for Christmas. I'm going to have a lot of games to run through and not enough time. So I cannot wait. This PlayStation 5, to me, has been a solid, great use of the money so far, just from playing Astrobot for the most part. I definitely recommend it. On a side note, the Xbox Series X, I haven't gotten the box, but again, with Game Pass, EA Play is now officially part of it. That's right. So 70 new games showed up, a bunch of sports titles, all of the Dead Spaces and all the Mass Effects and Dragon Ages, and just everything's opened up to Jedi Fallen Order's on that list.
Yes.
I already own it both for Xbox and PlayStation, so I'm good there, but it is available for those who have Game Pass for Xbox. So
even the new Destiny DLC is out for the Game Pass and everything like that. So
I recommend for those who are on, even if you still have your old Xbox, or if you're just humming and hawing on whether you should just get Game Pass and play it on a PC, I recommend you jump into that. There's so many more reasons of having that service. There's so many amazing games you can get right now. If you aren't able to get a PlayStation 5 or Xbox due to lack of stock and availability, this is a great way to play a bunch of games and paid the least amount of money.
Yeah, yeah. And the beta's done for the PC now, so it's open for the PC game.
Yes.
So it works out really well.
Also, they do ask you what media apps you want to have installed when you're booting up your PC, your PlayStation 5.
That's right.
I only installed my YouTube and Disney Plus. I didn't need any of the other features. Again, I want to save as much space as I can on my PlayStation.
Yeah.
But when you log in, you basically are in the games. Think of it as tabs, right? If you think of a browser, you have different tabs. You have games and media tab. On the games, you have your crossbar, you have all the games that are installed, and then you have your games library, and you have your share factory or whatever. That's you want right. to create, lab yeah. or whatever they call it. You have your marketplace. And then you have, if you tap the button, you have that quick bar they talked about where you can see like all of your achievement, your trophies, what do they call it? The activities.
Yeah.
The cards there. And if you want to jump into a party chat and all that kind of stuff, it's there. It's very snappy. It's very quick. So I thought that was a really cool interface. I jumped over to the media side, saw the apps there. Didn't really play in it very much. But I thought trying to get to my settings, I thought was a little cumbersome. I realized that you had to go up to the tab section and then go over.
Yeah, it took me a little while to
get your profile, right?
Yeah.
And then from there, you can go into settings and then go into, like for me, I wanted to set up a passcode so that, you know, someone could come over and just jump into my saves. And to find that, to go through the menus, took me a little while to kind of get used to the differences, but it's mostly the same with a couple of tweaks. I think overall it is snappier, which is great. I hope it stays that way. But I do think that there could be some improvements. What are your thoughts anyway?
I agree. It took me a little while to get used to the layout of it and how to get to settings and my profile.
Mm-hmm.
Also, holding the controller down does not bring up the option of turning, shutting off. So you have to go down to the bottom and go to the right and actually go on the power icon
mm-hmm.
and click rest mode or reset or shut off.
Yes.
So I would prefer holding down and just having that quick menu to put in rest mode or shut off or
not
anything
having
like
to
that,
tap
right?
through. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is what PS4 had, and it was very convenient and it's quick. So I hope they maybe update that. So because holding down the PlayStation button on the controller does nothing.
It's a tap.
Yeah.
It's literally push it, comes to your quick menu. And then you can click home to go back to the main home menu. But generally, they want you to always be in that game. They want you to be in a rest mode. They want you to be playing a game. You tap it, cool, go to rest. And then when you boot it up, you're back right into your game and you continue playing, which is all good and fine. I've always been nervous about doing that on my PS4 because I've always been worried about the game crashing or there's an update or a power goes out and it messes my save.
Yeah.
So I always, by habit, close my games down. And I figured with this gen, I wouldn't have to worry about that because of the quick boot ups, I can always close my games. So I thought, okay, maybe I'm going to leave it in rest mode and try it out.
That's what I've been doing. I've been leaving it in rest mode, but to put it into rest mode,
you still do a tap
to go down,
scroll over.
Holding it down and then putting it in rest mode would be so much easier.
Yes,
and quicker.
Yes.
Especially if they're trying to make things quicker for everyone.
Yeah. So we'll see if they make these improvements. But a quick word of caution for those who are jumping into Miles Morales. If you are jumping into the remastered version of Spider-Man, if you're playing that game and you put it into sleep mode, don't do it. It apparently causes your hard drive to crash. It causes a rebuild of your hard drive. And in some cases, and I don't know if this particular part of what information I'm going to give to you is true, some people have said that they bricked their consoles. Now, I don't know how much validity of the bricking is true, but there definitely have been reports of it crashing your PlayStation and then it having to rebuild the hard drive like it has done on the PS4. So if you brand your system, you don't want to deal with that and you know have issues like that, just don't put it into rest mode on remastered. Shut off the game before you put it to sleep, which is, like I said, with the boot times as they are, they're so quick, it's not a big deal.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so I mean, that's our overall thoughts on the PS5. We'll definitely be sharing a lot more information as we try into more games out, sharing some game footage and whatnot. But we wanted to kind of give you our thoughts. But what did you think? Did you get a Xbox Series X or a PlayStation 5 at launch? What are your thoughts on the new consoles? Leave a comment below. We'd love to hear from you. Click subscribe, like the video. And as always, friends, stay nerdy.